ॐ पूर्णमदः पूर्णमिदं पूर्णात् पूर्णम् उदच्यते पूर्णस्य पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। ब्रह्मानन्दं परं सुखदं केवलं ज्ञानमूर्तिं द्वन्द्वातीतं गगनसदृशं तत्त्वमस्यादिलक्ष्यम् एकं नित्यं विमलमचलं सर्वधी साक्षिभूतं भावातीतं त्रिगुणरहितं सद्गुरुं तं नमामि। ॐ Adorations to Sadhguru, who is Brahman, the giver of supreme bliss, embodiment of pure consciousness, one without a second, vast as the ether, infinite, eternal, beyond the three gunas and their modifications, the supreme preceptor. Yoga Vasistha, Nirvana, Prakarana, Purvārdha, section 44. Continues. The theme is Sadhana for destroying Asakti, attachment. And we have given highlights in that direction. Continuing this, Sage Vasistha imparts this wisdom to Sri Rama. Having controlled your vasanas and pranas, you will overcome this mind and thus witness the cessation of the world process. There are three steps: mala, vikshepa, and avarana. These are three great obstacles to be removed. Mala is removed completely by manonash. Manonash is that state of mind that stays with equanimity in pleasure, pain, gain, loss, and all variations of experiences. Then that's called manonash. Vasana akshaya, we have detailed upon it. How your Krishna vasanas must come to dagdha bija state. And avarana is removed by tattva jnana. If vasanas are destroyed, vasana akshaya, there is tattva jnana. Absolute revelation of the truth. In describing, you are describing in three stages. But three stages are like synonyms. If you have manonash, you are bound to have vasanakshaya. If you have vasanakshaya, you are bound to have tattva-jnana. So all three must go together. When you describe a person, start describe his legs, his trunk, his head. But the person has to be whole. There is no bliss greater than the bliss arising out of the dissolution of the mind. When all desires, along with their foundation, are dissolved, one experiences the infinite bliss of the self. Knowledge of the truth puts an end to the existence of the mind. Mind goes after vishaya-sukha, the trap of sense pleasure, and is constantly affected by raga dvesha, attachment, hatred, and all kleshas manifest through your mind. Egoism, fear of death, But when there is knowledge of the truth, who am I? The ego stage within your personality swells up with egoism. That's called asmita klesha. Led by asmita klesha, one becomes completely dominated by ignorance. No matter how many things you may attain by your ego, you end up in a state of absolute vanity, emptiness. But the greatest attainment is to shed the illusion of egoism, ahamkar. That's the worst car you possess, and get out of that car as quickly as possible. But that's the whole project of yoga, of religion, of the spiritual movement. Getting out of the grip of egoism to the revelation of I am. I am is absolute one without a second. Egoism, countless. I am is the sun. Reflections and illuminations are countless. So do not stay in the state of reflected sun. So knowledge of the truth puts an end to the existence of the mind. The mind that goes on creating raga dvesha, that mind becomes sublimated. And along with it, vasana kshaya, all your klishta vasanas are neutralized by shubha vasanas. And finally, your vasanas are completely transcended. No matter what vasana may swim, may flourish in your chitta, no matter how many clouds may exist in the sky, the sun is ever untouched, unaffected. So that type of revelation, I am the sun. The chitta of a jnani is sattva or purity itself. There's a big difference between the mind of the ajnani and the mind of the jnani. Ajnani is ignorant. Jnani, the mind is dominated by sattva. It is known as sattva patti. Mind that is dominated by rajas tamas, that's vipatti, trouble. Mind dominated by sattva, that is enlightenment. Sattva dominated mind is like the sky with shimmering clouds. The clouds that do not obstruct the light of the sun. Rather, they adorn the light. The sun becomes more beautiful when it passes through silvery clouds. So that allegorically, this is the state of sattvapatti. Let me give you a reiteration of the seven bhumikas, because that's dada parinyaya. The more you hear about it, seven, and you have 7 days project. Begin with shubhecha. You have lots of ichchas are desires and wishes, but behind your wishes and desires, if you do not have the very keen desire for attaining liberation, then all your desires are ashubh. They are vain. But if you have a deep-rooted sensitivity of aspiring for attaining liberation, that sensitivity doesn't mean that you will not have practical desires. That experience of shubhecha is a deeper attainment. You may not yourself be always aware when you say you have to have deep-rooted burning desire for attaining God realization. This doesn't mean you'll be burning every moment. You have created a mental process in which your soul is profoundly inclined to follow the path of light, and it cannot move away. The soul has become deeply engrossed in that movement. That is your shubhecha state, which expresses in your daily life in the form of having amazing patience, endurance to face challenges in your life and emerge stronger than before. And it is decked with spiritual virtues. Most importantly, bhakti, devotion to God. Love of God begins to develop more and more in your daily life, leading to gradual process of surrender and self-effacement. The more surrender, more self-effacement, greater is your clarity of your goal. Greater is the burning aspiration of your soul to realize, who am I? So understand all these details. Otherwise, your mind works upon, I don't have time for burning aspiration. What can I do? Stop doing all duties. Sit down, take Gita in your hand, and start burning up your aspiration. That's what, well, just reading scripture in a literal way without guidance, then that's where you end up to. And that is not reality. Reality is to live your life with rhythmical, integral yoga plan. And while doing so, internally, inwardly, this profound movement continues. You begin to develop all these spiritual qualities needed by a deserving aspirant, adhikaritva, vivek, vairagya, Shat-sampat, mumukshutva. When you begin to develop these with great eagerness, that eagerness is a mystical term, then you are in the stage of shubhecha. Shubhecha itself is a big dimensional attainment. All people are not with the same degree of shubhecha. But all those who are drawn to satsanga, the spark of shubhecha has started in their heart. So how much shubhecha one has, that depends upon one's own spiritual advancement. But no two persons will have the same degree of shubhecha until you are at the very higher state. Shubhecha immediately opens the door to vicharana. Vicharana is that reflective movement of your mind. Intellect in human being remains dull, quiet, shut up in a door. Most times Mendel said, doesn't like the intellect. Dominated by sentiments. The intellect says a voice. Don't you realize this is a perishable world? Who cares? Shut up. So the more you keep your intellect shut up, lesser is your capacity to do vichar. Vichar is to allow your mind to operate in the light of your intellect, not intellectualism. Intellect, as it gets purer and purer, and under the light of that intellect, your mind goes on developing a special change, purification. And that stage is called vicharana. It's a powerful movement, the gateway to liberation, vichar. Shubhecha, vicharana. The result of vichar, what does vichar do to your mental process? Tanu manasi. All the negative forces from your mind, all the negative in your mind begins to diminish, thin out. What are the negatives? Shadripus, kama, perverted desires, krodha, anger, lobha, greed, mada, conceit, matsarya, jealousy. All these restrict your vichar. But once vichar has sublimated these negative qualities, now sublimation again is in different degrees. If you have not completely sublimated, but just brought about degrees of purification, it may appear to you that you have conquered these malas. You have conquered your anger, your temper. See, nobody is to make you angry because you are locked out. So that type of illusion, that simply because you did not express anger, hate in your daily life, and people begin to admire you for how controlled you are, you think, oh, you have attained the goal. So that state is called tanu manasi, because it's not absolutely perfect, but it is an essential step. That's the way you gradually, first you thin out your impurities and then finally sublimate them. In tanu manasi, you are thinning out. If you stay with it, not go further, then all those impurities will dominate you and you will be completely frustrated. If you continue to sublimate, and your sublimation has reached its climax, now comes sattvapatti. Sattva here relates to a state where rajas, tamas are completely dominated by sattva. In order to understand that, you can gain insight from Ramayana, think of the role of Vibhishana. Vibhishana was sattva. He continued to help Ravana and Kumbhakarna. Ravana is Rajas. Kumbhakarna is Tamas. This was a demoniac set. But same sattva moves away from the demoniac set and joins Rama. Once the sattva has been kicked out of the demoniac set, Ravana kicks him out. Sattva joins Rama. And sattva becomes, Vibhishana becomes the most powerful aid for destroying Ravana. That sattva that has been unaffected by the domination of Rajas and Tamas, that sattva enhances your jnana and dhyana movement. Rama movement is jnana movement. Lakshmana movement, dhyana. Jnana and dhyana both become successful. That success is called sattvapatti. That type of sattva that allows meditation and spiritual inquiry, the whole process, to come to a great success. And that state of success is called sattvapatti. Sattva has dominated your mind. At this stage, soul becomes a jivan mukta. Because even though you are not enjoying absolute glory of enlightenment, one thing is secure, you can't go backward. Once you have secured that state, you have no other choice but to be drawn more and more towards liberation. So that state is called sattvapatti. Now, how does this state mature more and more? As this state matures, it's called asamsakti. Living in the same world, handling the same challenges in your life, performing similar duties, and yet untainted by raga, dvesha, attachment and hatred. Simply, crude illustration is given. Just handling in your kitchen all types of vegetables, platanos that have a lot of muck in their stuff. But when you have greased your hand in a special way, you can handle all that and remain untouched by that. Here, asamsakti is the same state. You are so greased by the spiritual revelation, aham brahmasmi, that though you handle all these, your hands are perfectly clean. You are untouched, untainted. And Rama becomes exemplary example. Prasannatam yanagata abhishekata tatana mamle banavasa dukkata. He was given a coronation of Ayodhya. He didn't become excited by elation. And when he was banished, he didn't sink into a state of dejection. Being completely untouched. That's the example of asamsakti. This state matures further. Padartha bhavana. All the product of prakriti is termed as padartha. Padartha, literal meaning is matter. All that matters to the soul is matter. And what matters to the soul? is Maya Shakti, soul being deluded. So when we say Prakriti, Maya Shakti, and Padarth, matter, they are like synonyms. And Padartha Abhavana, that Padartha will not, Abhavana means absence. So absence of Maya, absence of Prakriti, implies absence of matter. Nothing matters. And this attainment has an instinct in every human being, even in common parlance. Whenever you face something of a difficult nature, relief comes when you say, never mind. Doesn't matter. Negating mind and matter. But that's early stage of this understanding, mind and matter. Advanced stage, only matter. It's the matter that turns into mind and physical matter. And matter is Prakriti. That matter is Maya Shakti. And so that's the Kalpadartha Bhavana. In other words, in a simple way explained, just like in deep sleep, you are completely untouched by the world. In Padartha Bhavana, as if you are in deep, deep sleep. But it is only a simile. It shouldn't be taken literally. From literal point of view, you are more awake than anyone could be. More attentive to minutest detail of life. And yet, in turn, inward, heart level, sleep like the boundless sky. You are the sky, and the world of experiences continue like drifting clouds. But ask the sky, does it know, does it keep any record? Sky doesn't. Dub, completely drowned in sleep. That's Padartha Bhavana. And all these have come to six stages. Seventh is the absolute transcendence called Turiya. So, here is a mention of Sattvapatti. The chitta of a jnani is sattva or purity itself. It doesn't obstruct the vision of the essential self. Thus, O Rama, having realized the illusoriness of desires, enter into the transcendental nature of the self, wherein the world ceases to exist forever. Next section, 45. Brahman compared to a bilwa fruit. Bilwa fruit is a sacred tree, sacred in the worship of Lord Shiva. You offer bilwa leaves. Bilwa leaf has triplets, three-pronged leaves, which relate to seer, seen, and sight. Triad, triputi, the entire world process is essentially same as Brahman. And that's the theme, highlighted theme in this section. There is a gigantic bilwa fruit that includes all space and time within its expansion. It has not undergone any change or decay through countless ages. Think of the entire universe in summation, all that is. And that's allegorically the bilwa fruit. It's a universe sustained by Brahman. Think of Brahman, whose praise is being sung by one verse. And that's universe. Anything in this universe is a glory of Brahman. Whatever is happening in the universe, adversity, prosperity, positive, negative, countless lokas, and all details of the universe, they are Prakriti is singing the praises of Brahman through everything that happens. I'm also using allegorical language because we have no way to give straight description. The taste of this fruit cannot be described in terms of the senses. Senses, mind, and limited intellect cannot really experience the taste. The taste of the fruit is bliss absolute, paramananda. You become joyous even when you take something tasty and delightful. But that taste is far from the absolute taste, and you cannot mathematically multiply that one rasgulla tastes wonderful. Brahman must be a million rasgullas. I'm joking. You cannot multiply worldly pleasure and say Brahman is million times that type of. But then, for encouraging spiritual aspirants, the language is used that way. That God is like thousands of suns blazing together. The mathematical terms are used only for a purpose. Though fully ripe, it does not fall like fruits of ordinary trees. It is not born of any tree. It exists without roots, branches, flowers, or leaves. This fruit is your wisdom of revelation, Brahman alone. The entire universe is Brahman. That wisdom is being brought out through the simile of the bilwa fruit. So in that state, the branches, flowers, and leaves, they relate to different levels of experience. Experience through your senses are like branches. Experience through your sentiments like flowers. Experience of your practical realities, they are like leaves. But all these experiences are transcended in that wisdom state of consciousness. So that's the bilwa fruit. No one knows of its origin. Wisdom does not come under that description that when it was born and how long it continues and how long will it live. No one knows of its origin. It is a fruit that has no seed or pulp. You can't gulp it. No internal differentiations. There are neither external nor internal differentiation. is a mass of oneness, taintless and immutable. It is like a solid rock of bliss, which is devoid of internal pores. That's called Chidghana. It's a mass of bliss. But what a mass! It's like a solid mass, not ordinary, not scientific solid, because even that solid is porous. It's a mystic pop solid. There is no porousness in it. It is absolute. Or like the nectarine moon of bliss, overflowing with fullness. Its glory far surpasses that of Hiranyagarbha. All the glory of cosmic mind that you hear is nothing compared to Brahman the Absolute. It transcends time, space and causation. It is in fact the Self, devoid of duality, immutable and eternal, subtler than the subtlest, greater than the greatest, older than the oldest. This Self is devoid of all changes and modifications. This is a matter for reflecting upon this Self. What is this Self? Who am I? And for affirmation, you may use any one of these statements. Subtler than the subtlest, greater than the greatest, older than the oldest. The Self is devoid of all changes and modifications. The world exists in the Self like baseless imagination in the mind. How does imagination enter your mind? While imagination comes, there's a whole picture about the imagination. The whole world enters by the fingertip of your imagination. It's a big iPad, and your imagination tips. And big world opens up and then simply vanishes. It's nowhere. The Self enters into the world process, confined to time, space and causation. This point has to be understood by simple reflection. What happens when you go to deep sleep? You are there. Nothing of you is limited. But during sleep experience, you are not experiencing time, space, and causation. This shows that your essential nature is stripped of time, space, causation, which is the characteristic of the world process. It is the power of the Self that manifests in the form of the various aspects of time. Whatever you experience, even a minutest detail, you are experiencing a moment, a second, a minute, an hour, fortnight, month, year, age, kalpa. All your experiences are illusion. Moves by one tip, aham brahma. And similarly, all causations, all the history, all the geography, and all the details, why and how things happen. All these are operations of your citta, your mental process. And mental process brings about projections. Projections create their realities, but their realities are illusions. The reality remains the screen which gives value to projections. The screen is Brahman. That Brahman is I am. The self is within and without, to the left and to the right, near and at a distance. It is the all-encompassing reality. When you want to relate yourself to God, do not stress your mind. Where can I go? Which sacred place? What temple can give you the best experience? Rather understand, the self is within and without. If you like within, self is there. You want to be without, in the external world, self is there. To want left, right, up and down, and in any direction, near or at a distance, self is everywhere. That type of understanding is the best pilgrimage that you can ever enjoy. It is the all-encompassing reality. And dwell upon it. It's all-encompassing. And with this, I will conclude for today. Om Ram, 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 Ram. Om Namah Shivaya. Om Namah Shivaya. Om Namah Shivaya. Om. Prayer for shower of Karunamaya Rasa grace over all of you with the blessings of Shakti, Bhakti and Mukti. Om Trayambakam Yajamahe Sugandhim Pushti Vardhanam Urvarukum Vabandhanan Mrityor Mukshyama Mritat Om Sarve Bhavantu Sukhina Sarve Santu Niramaya Sarve Bhadrani Pashyantu Ma Kashchid Dukbhag Bhavet Om Shanti 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 Hari Om Tassa.